Loyola's run in NCAA tournament highlights flaws in current amateur model. To the average college basketball fan, Clayton Custer would have been more likely to be identified 2 weeks ago as a character in a Western than the Missouri Valley Conference Player of the Year. The supporting cast in Loyola-Chicago's run to the Final Four would have been even more anonymous, having received almost no national television time this year and playing on a team that was barely covered even by the local media until it started winning big for the first time in decades. The best thing about college basketball is that a team of this little pedigree or expectation could wind up playing for a national championship on the final weekend of the season while the Dukes, Kentuckys, Arizonas and Michigan States all fell by the wayside. To get to the Final Four, you have to earn it. But the opportunity only extends so far. If the system of college sports actually reflected the values of American society, Loyola Chicago's improbable run would be a once-in-a-lifetime chance for its players to capitalize on their sudden popularity. Custer might get offered a book deal, Marks Towns could spend the offseason at the mall earning a few thousand dollars to autograph pictures of his winning shot against Nevada. Center Cameron Krutwig might be valued enough by a local restaurant to appear in advertisements. Looking ahead, 5 bold predictions for the Final Four in San Antonio. Final Four Preview, Keys to Victory for Villanova. Kansas Semi-Final. Final Four Preview, Keys to Victory for Michigan. Loyola Semi-Final. Given that none of Loyola's players are likely to make the NBA, they'll probably never be more marketable than they are now. But under the guise of amateurism, a theory that has been abandoned by every other sporting enterprise except the NCAA, none of that is acceptable. If any of those players who are slated to return to Loyola next season took even a dime to profit off their newfound celebrity, they'd be ineligible. It doesn't have to be that way. And with scandal swirling around college basketball for the foreseeable future, it's time the NCAA answer one simple question. What intrinsic value is being preserved by maintaining the amateur model, and what is the greater good to which it contributes? NCAA President Mark Emmert is scheduled to speak Thursday afternoon at the Final Four at his annual news conference, but this one will be unlike any other in recent memory. Last September, the FBI arrested 4 assistant coaches and several others who were part of the machinery of college basketball's underworld, including financial advisors, agents and shoe company executives who were charged with corruption and fraud. Within the next month, a commission headed by former Secretary of State Condoleezza Rice is expected to make recommendations to the NCAA on changes that would purportedly help clean up the sport. While it's unclear how comprehensive those recommendations will be, some high-ranking college officials who've spoken with USA Today Sports expect to be briefed on the progress as soon as this weekend at the Final Four. Anything short of a full reconsideration of what amateurism means in the college context will fall short of the practical and moral responsibility of the NCAA to finally get this right. X factors: 8 unheralded players that could lead team at Final Four. One of a kind, Moritz Wagner's unique style has helped Michigan thrive based on what we've seen so far from the Pac-12 and Big East. However, there's little reason to think school presidents and athletics directors have the political will to do the obvious and allow college athletes to profit off their name, image and likeness the way that talented, high-achieving people are able to do in any other setting or context of American society, regardless of their age or whether they're a college student. Anything less than that serves only to maintain the interests of an antiquated system that concentrates money in the hands of coaches and administrators, who's typically explain their belief in amateurism not because they believe it's inherently pure but because they see the alternative as too messy and complicated. Given the current state of affairs, it's too late to worry about that. In the end, the solutions are simple if you start with a simple goal: what's best for the athletes. It's only when you start attaching other agendas that the ridiculousness seeps in. Take, for instance, the suggestion by both the Pac-12 and Big East that the NBA ain't the one-and-done rule, but that basketball players who choose to attend college will have to do so for a minimum of 2 or 3 years before being eligible to be drafted. This suggestion is totally self-serving and morally irresponsible, particularly if there's no mechanism to allow college athletes to recoup any of that lost income through name, image and likeness rights. Think about Oklahoma's Trae Young. A year ago, he finished as the 16th ranked player by Rivals.com and 23rd according to both 247 Sports and the ESPN 100. Given the way he was evaluated in high school, there is very little chance he would have entered the draft. He very much needed college as a platform to prove his skills, and he performed well enough to be a likely lottery pick this year, advancing to the NBA at the pace his talent, not some arbitrary rule, dictated. Under the Pac-12 proposal, Youngwood would be forced to stay at Oklahoma two more years or go off to a foreign country to play professional basketball because Commissioner Larry Scott and his cohorts have presented a false choice between